Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. Come and eat.
Now we get into the famous Leviticus 11, the law of clean and unclean meats, foods that are permitted and foods that are forbidden. This is the main chapter in the Torah that talks about clean and unclean meats, but its corollary is Deuteronomy 14, which is a kind of a an abbreviated version of Leviticus 11. Now, I'm not going to go through a long dissertation, a pontification on Leviticus 11, all the clean and unclean meat laws. I have several videos already that I've done on this, plus a very long teaching, written teaching, which is available on our website. But, and I've got a lot of videos actually on this subject, because subject of diet is a very big one, that, the Sabbath and the biblical feasts. But I just want to share briefly kind of what the heart and in essence of the biblical dietary laws are all about. And a lot of people think it's about the diet. It's about what we eat, and it's about health. And that's actually not the number one issue. Yes, those are issues, but that's not the number one concern on the Father's mind, the Elohim's mind, his heart, when it comes to giving the people of Israel and his people the dietary laws. The focal point of the biblical dietary laws are holiness and separation. How serious are you? You know, there are health considerations, you know, but by not eating these unclean animals. And that's another discussion. We won't go there. But we've explored that elsewhere, and there's a lot of documentation out there on that. But I want to ask the question, how serious are we about obedience to Jehovah's commands? Is our God our belly? Is our belly our God? Do we put the cravings of the taste buds ahead of obedience to Elohim? If so, our belly is like a small g, little god, or an idol. And people have all kinds of excuses why, you know, to justify their eating habits, when in reality, they're bowing down before the God of their taste buds. Philippians 3:19, Romans 6:16-18 talk about this. Do your taste buds, or the word of Elohim, rule your life? Remember, the Torah covers all aspects of life: physical, spiritual, emotional, relational, civil, agricultural, political, jurisprudence, religious, and economic. Torah is literally a holistic handbook on life. Are you one who takes a humanistic pick-and-choose approach to the Torah obedience? Again, we're back to the Swiss cheese Bible again. Do you have a holy Bible, a Bible with holes in it, H-O-L-E-Y, called the Swiss cheese version? Where if you don't like something, yeah, I don't like those dietary laws because I like my bacon. Rip it out of the book. I don't like the dietary laws because I like crab legs or lobster tail. Rip it out of the book. Let's be real about it. That's what we're doing. If that's our attitude. Let's explore this a little bit. Do you say, well, I'll only obey the biblical laws that suit me? I like my bacon, so I'm going to, you know, rip that page out of the Bible. Well, such an approach is akin to listening to what the serpent told Adam and Eve when he said, you can have it your way. Jehovah didn't really mean what he said when he gave you, you know, when he commanded you to be obedient and not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That's really the same philosophy of the serpent that he used to deceive Adam and Eve and con them into sinning. Let me just tell you that the biblical kosher laws involve many areas, such as health issues and holiness, not defiling the body or the temple of the Yehovah set apart spirit, and separation issues. It involves not just dietary, but it involves a whole lifestyle. which days we worship on, which holidays we keep, which days we rest on, what we do with our money. Do we give a part of our money to Jehovah? How we bathing ourselves and cleansing ourselves, and when to have sex with our wife, when not to, you know, how to treat diseases and quarantine issues and touching dead animals and cleanliness issues, and what to do with the waste that comes from our body, how to dispose of it. I mean, all of these things are holiness separation issues that we are called to do because we're called to a higher standard than the heathens and the pagans around us, because we are to reflect the presence and the glory and the light of Yehovah Elohim that he's given us. And how can we be salt and light to the world if we're grubbing around in the pig pen along with the rest of the world, wallowing around in the mud of profanity and pollution called human squalor and filth and moral degradation? How are we to lift people up out of the pit when we're wallowing in the pit ourselves and eating abominable foods and worshiping on days that are in honor of the sun god that he did not command? We're worshiping under churches that have phallic symbols on them, called steeples, and phallic symbols. And we're bowing down before Christmas trees to pick up presents because that are phallic symbols with testicles hanging on them. That's where they came from. The Bible says don't do those things in Jeremiah chapter 10. It describes a perfect Christmas tree there. Why are we eating things that the Bible calls an abomination? We're going to talk about that in a minute. We got to ask ourselves some serious questions. Am I really serious about Yehovah Elohim? If not, if I'm not serious, I may as well just shut my Bible and walk away. Eat, drink, and be merry. Go have fun. And, you know, live this life to the fullest. Disregard what he said. If you're going to go a little bit, you may as well go all the way. And don't make religious pretenses and theologies to justify your wickedness. But that's what the Christian church has been doing since the second century onward in many areas. Not all areas, but many areas, at least in the areas that we're talking about. So the biblical kosher laws involve a lot of things besides eating. The word kosher derives from the Hebrew word kasher. It's spelled kaf, shin, and resh. And it means to be straight, right, and acceptable. Yehovah has called his people out of this world and sanctified them. That's what when you see the word church in your New Testament, it's the word ekklesia, the Greek word. It means called out ones, called out of a larger group into a smaller group to be set apart. And the word saints is the word hagios, and it means to be, again, set apart, pulled out of a larger group, the world in this case, to be set apart. Yeshua in John, I believe it was 16 or 17, says, he told his disciples, well, actually it was in his prayer to the Father before he was apprehended, Father, help them. They are in the world, but they're not of the world. So he has called us, he hasn't given us the liberty. Yehovah has not given us the liberty to act, speak, dress, eat and live the way the heathens do, because we are called to be holy or kadosh and set apart from them so we can be like him. He has called us to higher standards, higher moral and spiritual standards. And we can't expect to be called the children of the Most High and still live like the children, the heathens, the pagans of this world. We must choose whom we are going to serve. As it says in Joshua 24, 15, choose ye this day who you will serve. But as for me, my household, we will serve Jehovah. And Yeshua said in Matthew 6, 24, you cannot serve Elohim and Mammon. I know Mammon means money, but it has to do with the God of this world and following the ways of this world in its broader application. Now, in Leviticus 11, verse 4, we read, nevertheless, these These you shall not eat among those that chew the cud or those that have cloven hoof. The camel, because it chews the cud but does not have cloven hooves, it is unclean to you. And then it goes to list another a lot of other animals that are unclean. The word, and we read that again in verse 47. Let me read, pick this one up. Oh, to distinguish, let's start in verse 46. This is the law of the animals and the birds and every living creature that moves in the waters, of every creature that creeps on the earth, to distinguish between the unclean and the clean, between the animal that they may be eaten and the animal that may not be eaten. So the word unclean here is the word tameh, T-A-M-E-H, and it means defiled, impure, polluted, ethically or ritually or religiously polluted. The word clean is a word tahor, T-A-H-O-R, meaning pure, physically, ceremonially, morally, and ethically. So in verse 43, which we just read, Yehovah says that in eating unclean meats, one becomes abominable or filthy. Let's read that again. I guess we didn't read that verse, actually. We read the ones after that. He says, you shall not make yourselves abominable with any creeping thing that creeps, nor shall you make yourselves unclean with them, lest you defile them. In fact, he uses the term abominable and abomination a number of times in this passage. We'll get to that in a minute with regard to eating unclean things. So he says here, eating unclean meats makes one abominable. The word abominable means detestable or filthy. I'm just giving you what the Bible says. You can argue with Yehovah all you want, and you can disagree with Yehovah all you want, and you can shoot me, the messenger, the mailman is giving you the message, but the Bible still says this. This is what the words mean, and this is what the creator of the universe is saying. I don't care if you like your pork, your ham, your bacon, your, you know, whatever. This is what the Bible says. I don't care what your pastor says. I don't care what some book you have on your shelf says. It goes against what the word of Elohim says. I don't care what modern science says. I don't care what your doctor says. I don't care what your mother-in-law says. I don't care what anybody says. Only what Yehovah says. It is the word of Elohim that will judge us. Are we living up to his standards or are we not? Either we are on the highway to heaven or going up, or we are going down. And if we do enough things that are contrary to the word of Elohim, we're going down. Okay? So now, once we come to a knowledge of the truth, we have to deal with it. And it's dangerous to listen to these videos, because you get exposed to the truth. Now you're accountable for it. What are you going to do? Are you going to repent and get right and bring your life into alignment and agreement with the word of Elohim? Or are you going to continue making excuses why you want to follow men and follow the lies of the devil that go against the word of Elohim? Traditions of men and the doctrines of men by which the word of Elohim has been made of none effect. Yehovah says, I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. I do not change. Both, he says that in the New Testament and the Old Testament. His moral and righteous standards don't change. Just because we're in the so-called New Testament dispensation, that does not mean that he's changed our gut. He hasn't changed his moral standards. He hasn't changed our digestive systems in our bodies. People will quote out of context all kinds of passages in the New Testament to try to prove it's all right to eat whatever you want. And they cherry pick these things out of context with no background. They're not reading the thing in its context. They're not looking at the Greek. They're not reading it in the context of what the author said or in the context of the entire Bible. And they cherry pick these things out and they make a false doctrine out of them. And I have addressed those both in writing and on videos. All these so-called scriptures in the New Testament that purportedly claim to invalidate the dietary laws for New Testament believers. And I show that you have been lied to. Our fathers have inherited lies. And when you go back and look at these things in their Hebraic context, you realize that's not what the apostles are saying. That may be hard for some people to believe because you've been brainwashed negatively in these areas for all your lives. But if you're an honest truth seeker and you love Yeshua, you really love him and you want to obey him and keep his commandments, you will go check these things out and you will prove like a good Berean to see if these things are true or not. So when we eat abominable foods, we become detestable or filthy or defiled, impure, polluted, ethically, religiously, and morally. Now, in Ezekiel 22:26, we read, Yehovah rebukes his people because her priests have violated my Torah law and have profaned my set apart or kadosh or holy things. They have put no difference between the set apart and the profane, the polluted or the common. Neither have they shown the difference between the unclean and the clean, and have hid their eyes from my Sabbaths, the weekly Sabbath and the annual holy day, feast day Sabbaths, and I am profaned among them. Boy, that sounds like a lot of modern day preachers that I have heard doing this, doing the very thing that Yehovah predicted back through Ezekiel, back in Ezekiel 22. They have not made a difference between the holy and the profane. You know, it just drives me crazy, these churches that they say, well, you cannot drink any alcohol. Forget drunkenness. We know that's a sin. But you cannot drink any alcohol. That's a cardinal sin. But then they bring in the Christmas tree on Christmas. They bring in the Easter bunny on Easter. And then they have Easter ham dinners in the church. And they profane the church on Easter. And maybe other times too by bringing in ham roasts. Ugh. So they've turned the word of Elohim on his head. That which he says you're supposed to do, they don't do. And that which he says don't do, they do do. Guys, it's time to wake up. It's time to get right with Elohim. It's time to put off these traditions of men that are bringing curses against the church and are leading the people away from Elohim. In Leviticus 11:45, we read, "For I am Yehovah that brought you up out of the land of Egypt to be your Elohim. You shall therefore be set apart, for I am set apart," or holy. This is in this chapter, Leviticus 11. This is a holiness issue. It's not a health issue as much as it is a holiness issue. To distinguish between the clean and the unclean, the profane and the holy, to be holy, for I am holy. Leviticus 11, verse, he mentions it twice here, verse 44 and verse 45. You shall be holy. Let me put it back. Let me read this again. Verse 44, for I am Yehovah your Elohim. You shall therefore consecrate yourself, set yourself aside for a holy purpose, and you shall be holy, kadosh, for I am holy. Neither shall you defile yourself with any creeping thing that creeps on the earth. For I am Yehovah who brings you up out of the land of Egypt to be your Elohim. You shall therefore be holy, or kadosh, for I am holy. You know, when Yehovah says something once, that's pretty important. We need to listen to it. But when he says it twice, the same thing, back to back, repeats it, reiterates it, that's like putting a double exclamation point at the end of the sentence. In 2 Corinthians 6:16 and 17, we read, "What agreement does the temple of Elohim," that's us, the temple of the Spirit, "have with idols? For you are the temple of Elohim, living Elohim, as Elohim has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them and be you separate, says the Master, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you." This could be applied to the eating of clean and unclean meats, the biblical dietary laws as well. That's an aspect of coming out of the world, of not allowing the temples of our bodies to be profaned by these pigs and shellfish that are garbage disposal systems of the earth, and put that stuff into our bodies. This issue of clean or pure, unclean, polluted, or abominable meats is not simply a dietary or health consideration, as we've already stated, but a spiritual issue with Yehovah. Both Moses in Leviticus 19:2 and the apostolic writers had a clear sense of the fact that without holiness, no one will see Elohim. Hebrews 12:14 says, without holiness, no one will see Elohim. And that holiness, or being kadosh, or being morally straight and pure and right, or set apart from the ways, lifestyles, ideologies of this world, which is a type of spiritual Egypt, is an absolute requirement of Yehovah for his people. Is it possible to spiritualize away the concept of set apartness and still be true to the word of Elohim? A lot of people try to. I wouldn't want to argue that point with Yehovah Elohim on Judgment Day, to be honest. Can one be spiritually sanctified or set apart through the atoning work of Yeshua at the cross and then have a polluted lifestyle? Good question. Why don't you ask Yehovah that? Ask his word. Ask yourself and be honest. Can one profess a righteous lifestyle and be set apart without walking out that lifestyle? Those that profess one thing and do something else, what did Yeshua call them? Hypocrites. And you know what he said about the hypocrites? He had some pretty choice words for them, and he called them some pretty derogatory names, like whited sepulchers, tombs full of dead man's bones that look good on the outside. Can one follow the spirit of the law and violate the letter and still be acceptable to Yehovah? What did James say about faith without works? He said it's dead, James 2:20. Faith without works. What did Yeshua teach on the Sermon on the Mount? He said you need the Spirit and the letter. We are to be the temple of the Spirit. And we got to take care of that temple. And what we eat, we have to be, that can defile a temple. Even as our thoughts and the evil things that come out of our hearts and out of our mouths can defile the temple. Yeshua taught on the Sermon on the Mount between Matthew 5 and Matthew chapter 7 that we must follow the Spirit and the letter. He said, you have heard it say unto you that you can, you're not to hate your brother, or you're not to murder, but it's all right to hate your brother. He said, you're not to hate your brother and you're not to murder. You have heard it said to you that don't have adultery, don't commit adultery with that woman, but it's all right to lust in your heart. He says, if you lust in your heart, you've already committed adultery. Don't do either. The letter and the spirit. The same is true of the Sabbath. People say, oh, well, I don't have to keep the Sabbath. I do one day in seven. I do whatever. And Yeshua said, no, you do the letter and the spirit. Same is true with, with what we eat. Well, he knows my heart. No, he knows your heart. He knows your heart is filthy and dirty and impure because you don't want to obey him. You're playing games with yourself, but you're not playing games with him. And those of us that see your life, we look at the fruit, not what the words come out of the lips. And by their fruits you shall know them, as Yeshua said in John chapter 7. That's called righteous judgment. John 7:24, judging a fruit or a tree by its fruit. So if you say one thing and you practice something else, you're a hypocrite and you're lying to yourself, but you're not lying to others who see, who know the truth of Elohim, and you're certainly not lying to the one that you will have to answer to on Judgment Day. I didn't make up the rules. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. It's up for you to bring your life into harmony with the word of Elohim. Now, in the Leviticus 11, we see the term abomination in verse 10, verse 20, verses 23, 41, and 42. All in relationship to unclean animals. They are an abomination to you. They shall be an abomination to you. Don't touch their carcasses. It's an abomination. Anything that does not have fins and scales, like crabs and oysters and lobsters, it's an abomination. All these other birds that you eat, these birds of prey, if you eat them, it's an abomination. Anything that does not chew the cud and any insects that you might eat, if there's a certain type of insect that's not kosher, it's an abomination. Every creeping thing that creeps on the earth shall be an abomination. It shall not be eaten. Whatever crawls on its belly, whatever goes on all fours, or whatever has many feet among all creeping things that creep on the earth. These you shall not eat, for they are an abomination. You shall not make yourselves abominable with any creeping thing that creeps, nor shall you make yourself unclean with them, lest you be defiled by them. For I am Jehovah your Elohim. You shall therefore consecrate yourselves, and you shall be holy, for I am holy. The word abomination is the word sheketz, S-H-E-Q-E-T-S, and it means a detestable thing or an idol. It also can mean to make abominable or to contaminate. This word is also used in connection with idolatrous practices, either referring to the idols themselves as being abhorrent and detestable to Elohim's sight, or to something associated with idolatrous ritual. This is according to the Theological Word Book of the Old Testament. And we see other things that are called abominations in Jeremiah 16:18, Ezekiel 5:11, Ezekiel 7:20, 2 Chronicles 15:8, to name a couple examples. Not only are the idols an abomination, but those who worship them become detestable as well. Hosea 9, verse 10. In fact, the word abomination in the phrase abomination of desolation, which occurs in Daniel 9:27, and 12:11 is the same Hebrew word, sheketz. It is generally viewed that this prophecy was fulfilled by the Syrian Greek Antiochus Epiphanes, who was a foreshadow of the Antichrist, prophetic foreshadow. And when he set up when he defeated the Jews, conquered the land of Israel, and set up an idol of Zeus in the Jerusalem temple. So the word sheketz and its cognates, the verb and the noun, relate to certain practices like unclean meats or idol worship that Jehovah is attempting to impress upon his people with extreme gravity of the sin they are committing against him when he calls it an abomination. So eating unclean food and meat is an abomination. That's very strong language that Jehovah himself uses. Utter abhorrence, detestable kinds of things. And he says in Leviticus 11:44, and we've read this verse already, be holy, or kadosh, for I am holy, or kadosh. He mentions that again in verse 45. He also mentions this same phrase in Leviticus 19:2, 20 verse 26, and Peter, 1 Peter 1:16. How do we as redeemed believers become kadosh, or set apart? Well, we could give a whole teaching on this, but briefly, we are made clean by the blood of Yeshua, the Lamb of Elohim, at the time of our initial salvation, revelation. And that's when we are washed of our sins, and all that unholiness and impurity and profaneness goes and is washed away. Let me read Revelation 1, verse 5. And from Yeshua, the Messiah, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. So we can become defiled by going against the laws and the commandments of Elohim and doing abominable, wicked practices, things that the Bible calls an abomination, such as eating unclean food. It's not food, really. Food is only that which is edible and the Bible considers clean. Pork is not considered food biblically. It's called treif. It is not food. It is something else. It is meat, but it's not food. It's unclean meat. Biblically, pork, shellfish, and all of those things are not food. Food is only that which the Bible, the Word of Elohim, has specified as food, here in Leviticus 11. So we come to Yeshua and he washes away of all that defilement. Isaiah 1:18 says something similar. Jehovah speaking, Jehovah says, come now, let us reason together, says Jehovah. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. So once one is cleaned up of all the sinful practices and habits that you did before you knew better, and once you come to knowledge of the truth and you bring your life in alignment with the word of Elohim and start living a holy, set-apart lifestyle, not living like the heathens, eating what they eat, practicing the holidays, doing the practices that they practice, you know, working on the Sabbath, all those things that they do, worshiping other gods and so forth. How, now we must ask the question, how does one stay set apart or sanctified and stay in fellowship with a Kadosh Elohim? This is accomplished by staying under the blood of Yeshua, the Lamb of Elohim, and confessing and forsaking sin. So as we are going along in the road of life and we stumble and we do something we shouldn't as redeemed believers, we violate His commandments. Remember, sin is a violation of the Torah, 1 John 3:4. Then what do we need to do on a regular basis? Well, 1 John 1:6-9. We stay under the blood of Jesus, Yeshua. When we violate His commandments, when we stumble, when we do something we shouldn't, we repent and go do the right thing. Let me read what it says here, starting in 1 John 1, verse 6. If we say that we have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, or which is sin or Torahlessness, we lie and do not the truth. What is the truth? The truth is the Torah. It's His instructions and righteousness. That's how the Bible defines truth. I could give you this scripture and verse, but we'll do that another time. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. The light represents the light of His truth, the light of His Torah, the light of all the word of Elohim. One of the points of light says, you shall not eat abominable meat. Unclean meat. That's one of the aspects of His light. We have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Messiah Yeshua, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Righteousness is Psalm 119:172 says, all thy commandments, thy Torah commandments, are righteousness. That's His laws, which define righteousness. And we are to put on the robes of righteousness. And when we do righteousness, we become righteous. Yes, we are given the righteousness of Yeshua, but He expects us to walk in His paths of righteousness. And that means what we eat. Not eating things that the Bible calls an abomination and that defile and make us unclean, for we are the temple of the Spirit. But eat those things which elevate us and bring us closer to Elohim, because we're regarding ourselves, our bodies, as the temple of the Spirit, and we also have respect for Yehovah Elohim, and we don't want to do anything that's going to defile us and separate us from Him, and we want to be like Him, for He beckons us and invites us and helps us and instructs us and leads us and sends us Yeshua and the Spirit to guide us in the way to be holy as He is holy. Because unholiness cannot dwell in the presence of Elohim. He is set apart. He is holy. And only a holy people are going to be in His presence forever and ever. So be holy, for He is holy. And it says in Hebrews 12:14, without holiness, no one will see Elohim.
While He may be found, call upon His name. He is near. Yeshua Hashem Behimatzov Kerabu. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon his name. He is near. Yeshua Hashem Behimatzot Geraua.